A very good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Hindi News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy. Today is the fourth day of Shankar IAS Academy's free mains scholarship test 2020. Today's question, that is the fourth question, is given at the end of the analysis. Now let's get to the Hindi News Analysis for the date 30th July 2020. These are the list of news articles chosen for today's analysis. It has been given along with the page numbers of different editions of Hindu newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping for the displayed articles is given in the description and also in the comment section. Let's move on to today's first discussion. The first discussion is based on these news articles, which are with reference to the hot topic for today, that is the new education policy of 2020. Yesterday, that is on 29 July 2020, the Union Cabinet approved the National Educational Policy 2020 and thus making way for large-scale and transformational reforms in both school education sector and higher education sector. And know that this NEP 2020 replaces the National Policy on Education of 1986. So in this context, we'll be only discussing the salient features of this policy today. We will not be analyzing it critically because in the following days, we'll be receiving many editorials and for that, we will create a base today. The syllabus relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now first, let us see few measures announced by the policy in the field of school education. First, the policy emphasizes that the medium of instruction is to be in mother tongue or local language or regional language. And this has to be followed at least till grade 5 or preferably till grade 8 and beyond. And then there will be three language formula, but there will be a greater flexibility as the three languages to be learned by the children will be the choices of the states or the choices of the regions or the choices of the students themselves. That means no language will be imposed on any state. And this will be the case so long as at least two of the three languages are native to India. Now that means the NEP 2020 has taken a refined stand with respect to what was earlier made with the draft NEP released in 2019. Because at that time, if you remember, it was reported that one of the three languages must be Hindi. But now the stand is that no language will be imposed on any state. And just remember, the draft NEP was drafted by the committee chaired by former chairperson of ISRO, Dr. Kasturi Rangan. The next, the policy emphasizes on early childhood care and education because 3 to 6 years of age is crucial for development of mental faculties of a child. Therefore, for this, the 10 plus 2 structure of school curricula is to be replaced by a 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4 curricular structure. So if you add this, you will get 15 years. That means the new system will have 12 years of schooling with 3 years of Anganwadi or preschooling. Then the policy recognizes foundational literacy and numeracy as an urgent and necessary prerequisite to learning. Therefore, the policy aims to set up a national mission on foundational literacy and numeracy. Now, with reference to this, the states will prepare an implementation plan for attaining universal foundational literacy and numeracy in all primary schools for all learners by grade 3. Now, this universal foundational literacy and numeracy is to be achieved by the year 2025. Then the school curricula are to undergo significant reforms, such as there will be reduction in curricular content so that more focus can be given on enhancing essential learning, critical thinking, and much greater focus can be given on experiential learning. Now here, students will have increased flexibility and choice of subjects. And at the school level, there will be no rigid separations between arts and sciences, between curricular and extracurricular activities. And also there will be no rigid separations between vocational and academic streams. And more importantly, the vocational education will start in schools from the 6th grade. And this will include internships also. So in this regard, a new and comprehensive national curricular framework for school education 2020-21 is to be developed by NCERT. Now, in order to make school education equitable and inclusive, the policy also aims to give special emphasis to socially and economically disadvantaged groups. And for this, a gender inclusion fund is to be set up and then special education zones are to be set up for disadvantaged regions and groups. And these measures will enable the children with disabilities to fully participate in regular schooling process from the foundational stage to higher education. So these were some of the measures announced by the policy in the field of school education. Now let us see a few important features with reference to higher education sector. And in this, the first and foremost policy which is announced is that the policy aims to increase the gross enrollment ratio in higher education, including vocational education. Now, this gross enrollment ratio or GER in higher education is targeted to increase from 26.3% in 2018 to 50% by the year 2035. And for this, 3.5 crore new seats are to be added to higher education institutions. Then the policy also envisages broad-based, multidisciplinary and holistic undergraduate education with a flexible curricula. So there will be creative combination of subjects. Then there will be integration of vocational education. And more importantly, there are going to be multiple entry and exit points with appropriate certification. See, the policy says that undergraduate education can be of 3 or 4 years with multiple exit points, and appropriate certification will be provided to students at the time of exit in each period. Now, for example, if the student exits in 1 year, then the student will be given a certificate. Then if the student exits after 2 years, then the student will be given advanced diploma. Then bachelor's degree will be given after 3 years, and then bachelor's degree with research will be given after 4 years. So experts say that this in a course of time will mean that those who completed 4 years of UG can directly start their research career. So based on this, we can say that at some levels, this policy may take away the importance which the master's degree has now. Now, coming to multiple entry and exit points, here the policy notes the credits earned by the students in different periods will be digitally stored in an academic bank of credit. Now, this will be a great blessing for the students who discontinue higher education for various reasons. Because now these students can move on in life temporarily with appropriate certificates or with a diploma. Then whenever possible, they can use the credits earned from the credit bank and they can complete the remaining part of the degree program. So that means this policy will remove the tagging of discontinuing students as dropouts. And additionally, if they exit after 1 year or 2 years, they may get some experience with their certificate or advanced diploma, and then they can complete the degree. So we can say that this is one of the important measures under this policy. Now, after this, the policy states that the PG programs can be a 1 year program or a 2 year program. And more importantly, MPhil programs are to be discontinued. Then after this, to encourage strong research culture and building research capacity across higher education, a National Research Foundation will be created as an apex body for this purpose. Then in higher education, the policy calls for light but tight regulation of higher education institutions. Now in this regard, there will be a single regulator with separate verticals for different functions. Now, this regulator is to be called as Higher Education Commission of India. And this Higher Education Commission of India will be a single overarching umbrella body for the entire higher education, but excluding the medical education and legal education. Now, this regulator will have 4 independent verticals, as you can see here. And according to experts, UGC, All India Council for Technical Education, that is AICTE, then National Council for Teacher Education are to be brought in under this regulator only. Then finally, with reference to financing the education, the center and states will work together so that they can increase the public investment in education sector to reach 6% of the GDP as soon as possible. Currently, if you see, this number is reportedly around 4.4% of GDP only. So that is all about this discussion. Moving on to the next discussion. This discussion is based on this OPED article, which is very much relevant in the current COVID-19 pandemic scenario, since it is causing unprecedented damage to the human life and damaging economies across the world. See, during lockdowns, we have heard the news of sambar deers walking on the streets in Uttarakhand in our country, then olive ridley turtles coming ashore in Odisha and similar events. And these happened because of reduced human activity. And some even said that the animals are reclaiming their old habitat. But here the problem is infectious diseases. And the infectious diseases such as Ebola, bird flu, MERS, SARS, Nipah, and even finally COVID-19. Because the important point to note among these diseases is that these are all zoonotic diseases. That means the harmful germs like viruses carried by these animals spreads to people and they cause disease in people. And one of the reasons for such kind of spreading of zoonotic diseases believed by scientists across the world is the loss of biodiversity and also wildlife trade. They feel that these two have strong linkages with the emergence of such diseases. And this OPED article has given an insight into this issue, and we will discuss it today. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. First, let us see how our actions affect biodiversity. Human beings have indiscriminately destroyed forests for agriculture, and they have destroyed forests for mineral extraction, etc. And one of the recent examples which we can quote is the destruction of Amazon rainforests. Now, these human-induced environmental changes have destroyed the habitats of several species and they have reduced the biodiversity. Not only this, it has also brought us closer with the pathogens which are carried by the animals. Then other than this, the main reason for loss of biodiversity is also illegal wildlife trade. And according to the author of this article, trafficking in wild plants and animals and wildlife products has become one of the largest and most lucrative or profitable forms of organized crime in the current world. And as you know, India is home to a large number of vulnerable and threatened species. So such kinds of organized crime also happen in our country. Even an NGO based in Assam has noted that the body parts of animals such as pangolins, Asiatic black bears and rhinos are being traded illegally to the countries such as China, Vietnam and Laos. If you even consider the current pandemic situation, there is strong evidence that the virus has spread from the wildlife market in Wuhan of China. So the virus has either directly transmitted from bats to human or it has transmitted from bats to pangolins and then to humans. However, the transmission happened, but it happened from animals to humans only. And we are now suffering from our actions and still we haven't learned the lesson, according to the author. It is because author notes that there is increase in the poaching of wild animals in India even during the lockdown period. For this, author has cited a global assessment report on biodiversity and ecosystem services by the IPBES. See here, IPBES stands for Intergovernmental Science Policy Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. It is an independent intergovernmental body which was established in 2012 and it aims to strengthen the science policy interface for biodiversity and ecosystem services. And this is for the conservation and sustainable use of biodiversity, then also for long-term human well-being, etc. Now, according to this IPBES report, people have extensively encroached natural habitats and thus biodiversity is declining significantly. So that means it is we, humans, who have created ideal conditions for the spread of viruses from animals to humans. So now, how to tackle this situation and what is the way forward? First and foremost, we must realize that biodiversity is the common heritage and it is natural capital of humankind. So it is time for the global community to realize the consequences of the unscientific actions which humans do on nature. And not only this, consequently, we must also prepare for the behavioral change, such as not disturbing the biodiversity. So this has to be done from the side of citizens. Now, from the policy perspective, what should be done by the governments across the world? In this first, the national development plans in post-COVID-19 world should mainstream biodiversity. We can even take the example of the Convention on Biological Diversity, which has put forward a 2050 vision for biodiversity. And this 2050 vision document focuses on approaches to living in harmony with nature. So all nations shall work together to realize this goal. And apart from this, author also suggests that we must follow a One Health approach. See, a One Health approach is an approach which is designed and implements the programs, policies, legislations and research in which multiple sectors communicate and they work together to achieve the better public health outcomes. So based on this, author suggests that under a One Health approach, preferences should be given to the health of people, to the health of the wild animals and domesticated animals, and also to the health of the environment. So this can be done from the policy perspective globally. Now, with respect to India, we have the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, and this aims to curb illegal trade in wildlife. Then we have the Biological Diversity Act of 2002, and this focuses on conservation of biodiversity and its sustainable use. So we must strictly follow these laws, and we must also try to achieve the pending national biodiversity targets under the Convention on Biodiversity. See, as you can see here, India has agreed to 12 national biodiversity targets under the CBD. Now in this, the first target talks about raising awareness of values of biodiversity. Then the second target wants to integrate the values of biodiversity in national and state planning processes. Then the third target provides for framing strategies for reducing rate of degradation, fragmentation and loss of all natural habitats. So like this, 12 targets focus on restoring the biodiversity and safeguarding the existing biodiversity. And if you see, according to the 6th National Report to the Convention on Biological Diversity, which was submitted by India in 2018, India has exceeded or overachieved 2 national biodiversity targets. So according to this 6th National Report on CBD, India is on track to achieve the 8 national biodiversity targets, and India is striving to meet the remaining 2 targets by the stipulated time of 2020. Because as you can see here, all the targets or most of the targets have to be achieved by the year 2020. And here just know that the 2 targets in which India has exceeded the agreed targets is target 6 and target 9. So by the end of this year, we will know whether India has achieved all these targets or not. And this is what is also suggested by the author. So based on this, author concludes that our mission should be mass biodiversity literacy. And if this can be achieved, we can hope to preserve our ecosystem, which in turn will help us to regulate diseases, and it will restrict the transmission of pathogens from one species to another. So that is all about this discussion. Now, this next news article mentions that Indians have become the largest diaspora group in Australia who are to be granted the country's citizenship in the year 2019-20. In this time period, around 38,000 Indians became Australian citizens. And this is a 60% increase from the previous year. So in this context, it becomes important to know about India-Australia relationship. India and Australia established diplomatic relations in the pre-independence period itself. So regular leaders' meetings are conducted by both the countries. And there is also an Australia-India Council, which was established in 1992. Now, this Australia-India Council broadens the relationship between Australia and India by raising awareness and promoting ideas and people-to-people exchanges. Now, with respect to the field of education, you should note that education is Australia's largest service export to India. It accounts for around 85% of the total service exports. And there were more than 1 lakh students from India studying in Australia in 2019 itself. But remember that India is second only to China. And to enhance this relationship, there is also a Australia-India Education Council. It was set up to provide a platform for ministerial engagement on policy and operational issues across education. And this council is co-chaired by education ministers from both the countries. Now, with respect to bilateral trade, know that the two-way goods and services trade of India and Australia was around $30 billion in 2018-19, and the level of two-way investment was $30.7 billion in 2018. Now, in this regard, you should know about the Bilateral Strategic Partnership of India-Australia, which was concluded in 2009. Now, this partnership was elevated to a Comprehensive Strategic Partnership in June 2020. Now, through this comprehensive strategic partnership, both countries have committed to work together across a range of areas. It includes a commitment to encourage expanded trade and encouraging investment flows to the benefit of both the economies. And know that as part of this comprehensive strategic partnership, Australian and Indian foreign and defense ministers have decided to meet to discuss strategic issues in a 2+2 format, and that too at least every 2 years. 2+2 means Indian Foreign and Defense Minister, and then on the other side, Australian Foreign and Defense Minister. Then, as you know, India-Australia engages in various defense relations, and one such example is AusIndex, which is a bilateral maritime exercise. Then there is also a civil nuclear cooperation agreement between both the countries. It was signed in 2014 and it came into force in 2015. Now, this agreement supports the supply of Australian uranium to India for civil use. This agreement also ensures that any future bilateral trade in other nuclear-related material or nuclear-related items for civil use will be protected. Now, if you focus on Indian diaspora, know that Indian diaspora in Australia comprises of both Australians of Indian origin and also Indians resident in Australia. And as we saw in the beginning, Indian diaspora is now Australia's fastest growing large diaspora. And according to the news article, know that around 6,20,000 people in Australia have declared that they were of ethnic Indian ancestry. And this was known in their Australian Bureau of Statistics 2016 census. And this comprises of 2.8% of Australian population. So in this sense, remember that India remains Australia's largest source of skilled migrants. And also, India is the second largest source of international students, as we already saw. So that is all about this discussion. The displayed practice question will be discussed in the last session. Moving on to the next discussion based on this news article. This article talks about a survey report relating to the misuse of antibiotics in dairy sector and the related concerns. See, this discussion becomes important because already there is a mains question which appeared in 2014 in GS paper 3. The question asks, can overuse and free availability of antibiotics without doctor's prescription be contributors to the emergence of drug-resistant diseases in India? What are the available mechanisms for monitoring and control? Critically discuss the various issues involved. And keeping the report in mind, we will discuss the findings of the report and we will also see what do we mean by antimicrobial resistance, antibiotic resistance, and what are the causes and consequences of this antibiotic resistance. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Now, first know that the report is released by the Center for Science and Environment. It is a public interest research and advocacy organization based in New Delhi. Now, as we already saw, this report talks about the misuse of antibiotics in dairy sector and the related concerns. The report mentions that antibiotics are used indiscriminately by dairy farmers and it is used to treat diseases in animals such as mastitis. See, this mastitis is a common disease in cattle and the animals contracted due to poor farming and milking hygiene. That is, if an animal sits on an unclean floor immediately after being milked, then microorganisms enter its body through the udder and they cause the disease, which is the inflammation of the udder. Now, using antibiotics to treat the disease is not a problem. The problem is that for treating this disease, farmers sometimes use the antibiotics which are not recommended in Department of Animal Husbandry Farmer Manual. See, in this table, the one which are starred are recommended by Department of Animal Husbandry for treating mastitis. But the problem is, the farmers also use the other antibiotics which are listed in this table that are not recommended by Department of Animal Husbandry. And such antibiotics includes the critically important antibiotics for humans and they are used in animals by farmers. This is dangerous because there is already a warning by WHO that these critically important antibiotics should be preserved in the view of growing crisis of antibiotic resistance. See, according to WHO, critically important antimicrobials or antibiotics are the limited therapies to treat human infections caused by bacteria from non-human sources. And out of these CIAs, some are also categorized as highest priority critically important antimicrobials. So that means if farmers use these limited therapies available for human in a cattle, that means when humans develop that disease and when human is given this antimicrobial or antibiotic, it will not be effective because we would have developed antimicrobial resistance by then. See, this happens because most farmers give the injections without even knowing which antibiotic should be given and what dose should be given. And as a result of this, they end up underdosing the animal or overdosing the animal. And further, if an antibiotic is ineffective, they simply change it. That means sometimes multiple antibiotics are also used to treat a single disease. Now, since farmers overuse antibiotics, it makes the healthy milk that we drink unhealthy. Now, this problem is aggravated as there are times when milk comes from sick animals under heavy antibiotic treatment. See, here you should note that there is a time period called as withdrawal period. See, this is the time after the last day an antibiotic is administered and before the milk is sold. And during this period, farmers must not sell milk because in this period, there are increased chances of antibiotic residues in the milk. But the problem is, farmers do not even know about this withdrawal period. So, they milk the animal even when it is under heavy antibiotic treatment. And all this becomes a problem because, according to the report, consuming the milk which is drawn during the withdrawal period can lead to resistance against antibiotics. And here some may think that if we boil the milk, antibiotics can be eliminated. But according to the report, some of these studies show that boiling or even pasteurization of milk may not completely eliminate antibiotics. So that means there will be definitely antibiotic residue or residue remains in the milk and it causes the antibiotic resistance. Now, why we are so much concentrating on this antibiotic resistance? What is it? Before that, you should know about antimicrobial resistance or in short AMR. It is the ability of a microorganism to stop an antimicrobial drug from working against it. Now in this, the microorganism could be bacteria, viruses or some parasites. And here the antimicrobials are the antibiotics, antivirals and antimalarials etc. These together are called as antimicrobials. and they help to prevent and control a disease. So if these antimicrobials do not work, then standard treatments to diseases and infections will become ineffective. So infections will persist or they will continue, and these infections may even spread to others. Now, when the same thing happens to an antibiotic, it is known as antibiotic resistance. See, as you know, antibiotics are the medicines used to prevent and treat bacterial infections. And an antibiotic resistance occurs when bacteria changes its response to the use of these medicines and they become resistant to the antibiotics. That means these bacteria may infect humans and animals, and the infections they cause even becomes harder to treat than those infections which are caused by non-resistant bacteria. So what is the reason behind this antibiotic resistance, or what causes antibiotic resistance? As we already saw in today's discussion, first is misuse of antibiotics or antimicrobials in animals or even in horticulture and fisheries also. Apart from this, there are also other reasons such as the inappropriate use of antibiotics in humans and even overuse or abuse of antibiotics by humans themselves. This also causes antibiotic resistance. Then even the animal manure, which contains antibiotic residues, causes bacteria in soil to become antibiotic resistant. And then when we grow produces in that soil, that vegetables and fruits will also have that antibiotic residue, and it will cause antibiotic resistance in humans. And then it is also caused by inadequate treatment of effluents that contains antibiotic residues from pharmaceutical industry, healthcare facilities, etc. And these are some of the other causes noted down. Now, what is the consequence of such antibiotic resistance? See, this kind of resistance leads to higher medical costs, prolonged hospital stays, and even it causes increased mortality. See, already new resistance mechanisms are emerging and spreading globally, and it is threatening our ability to treat common infectious diseases because the antibiotics have become less effective to these diseases. And because of this antibiotic resistance, the first line antibiotics can no longer be used to treat infections. That means more expensive medicines must be used. And this may lead to a longer duration of illness and longer duration of treatment. That means it will lead to a longer stay in hospitals. And hence it increases the healthcare costs as well as it causes economic burden on families and societies. Apart from this, even the procedures such as organ transplantations, chemotherapy and surgeries, they become more dangerous because when there is antibiotic resistance, the antibiotics cannot be used to prevent or treat the infections which are caused by these surgeries, chemotherapies or organ transplantations. So in this way also it poses a health risk. So that means antibiotic resistance not only leads to mortality, it also leads to economic problems and health crisis also. So that is all about this discussion. Moving on to the next discussion based on this news article. Now before that, I apologize in prior for any mispronunciations in this discussion. Now this news article mentions that the Uttar Pradesh Sunni Central Waqf Board has set up a trust. See, as you know, they already accepted the 5 acres of land allotted to them by the UP government for building a mosque. Now for this, a trust called as the Indo-Islamic Cultural Foundation has been formed to build a mosque in Ayodhya. Now in this, know that Waqf means an endowment or finance which is made by a Muslim to a religious, educational or charitable cause. And the plural of this Waqf is Waqf, if I'm not wrong. Now these Waqf boards exist in different states, either for a particular state or for a group of states also, depending on the population of Muslims in that particular state. And these Waqf boards exist for both Sunni and Shia sects of Muslims. I know that these Waqf boards are administered as per the Waqf Act of 1995. And to manage all the Waqf boards, there is a Central Waqf Council also. Now, this Central Waqf Council is a statutory body under the administrative control of Ministry of Minority Affairs. It was set up in 1964 under the Waqf Act of 1954. See, previously it was an advisory body to the central government on matters concerning the working of the Waqf boards and also the due administration of the Waqf. But the role of the council was expanded significantly after the amendment to the act. That is after the Waqf Amendment Act of 2013. And now the council is empowered to advise the central government, state governments and state Waqf boards. It can issue directives to the boards or state governments to furnish information to the council on the performance of the board, particularly like information on their financial performance, revenue records, encroachment of Waqf properties or even audit reports, etc. I know that the Council envisions the protection, retrieval and e-monitoring of Waqf under the provision of Waqf Act of 1995, which was amended in 2013. And this council also plays a proactive role in protection development of Waqf, and it works closely with the state Waqf boards to improve their functioning. And the council has a chairperson. It is headed by the union minister in charge of Waqf, who is none other than the union minister of minority affairs. Then it also has other members, and according to the act, it should not exceed 20 in number. And these members are appointed by the center. So that is all about this discussion. Here you should make note of the Waqf boards and about the Central Waqf Council. The display practice question will be discussed in the last session. Let's move on to the next discussion. Now we have come to the last session for the day, which is the practice questions discussion session. This first question is a map-based question. Question asks, which of the following is the correct order of places if one moves from west to east in Australia? Four places are given and we have to arrange them in west to east order. The four places are Great Barrier Reef, Lake Eyre, then Great Victoria Desert and then Perth. Now here first to know that Perth is the western coast of Australia. So that means it should be the first one in the order because we are arranging from west to east. So from this, you can easily eliminate options A and B. And then Great Barrier Reef is in the northeastern coast of Australia in the Coral Sea. So it should be in the last. But if you see, both the options have Great Barrier Reef at the last. Now from this map, you can say that Great Victoria Desert comes first when we move from west to east. Then comes the Lake Eyre. So the correct answer to this question is option C, Perth, Great Victoria Desert, Lake Eyre, Great Barrier Reef. Now this next question is a previous year question which was asked in 2019. It is about multi-drug resistance, or we can say antimicrobial or antibiotic resistance also. The question asks, which of the following are the reasons for the occurrence of multi-drug resistance in microbial pathogens in India? Now we saw the reasons in our discussion. The first one given is genetic predisposition of some people. Second, taking incorrect doses of antibiotics to cure diseases. Third, using antibiotics in livestock farming. Fourth, multiple chronic diseases in some people. Now, we saw 2 and 3 as reasons, but we did not see 4 as reason or first one as reason. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 and 3 only. Now, this is a practice question on antimicrobial resistance. The first statement is, it occurs primarily when human immune system gets strengthened and becomes resistant to microorganisms. This is incorrect because antimicrobial resistance is the ability of a microorganism to stop an antimicrobial drug from working against it. It is not the ability of the humans to resist because of immunity. So first statement is incorrect, and here the question asks for the incorrect statements. So one should be in answer. We can eliminate options C and D. Now the second one is, it helps to reduce the medical costs and mortality. Now we saw that antimicrobial resistance increases the medical costs and mortality. So this statement is also incorrect. And hence the correct answer is option A, 1 and 2 only. The third option is correct because it mentions use of antibiotics in animals, horticulture and fisheries can cause antimicrobial resistance. It is a correct statement. Now let us take one more prelims question based on Central Waqf Council. First statement is, it is a statutory body set up under the National Commission for Minorities Act 1992. Now in a hurry, don't think it is the correct answer because it is a statutory body, but it was set up under the Waqf Act of 1954, not under the National Commission for Minorities Act. So this statement is incorrect. Now the second statement mentions the Union Minister of Minority Affairs is the ex officio chairperson of the Central Waqf Council. Now this is a correct statement. And here the question also asks for the correct statements. So the correct answer is option B, 2 only. Now let's take up the mains question for the Shankar IAS Academy's Free Mains Scholarship Test 2020. Today's question is the fourth question for the test. Read the question carefully and answer accordingly. The question is, explain the salient features of the National Education Policy 2020. Do you think it is efficacious enough to resolve the long pending issues in the education sector? This is a 15 marks question and you have to write the answer within a word limit of 250 words and within 3 pages maximum. You can take a printout of the mains answer sheet, and the link for this is given in the description and also in the comment section. And if you do not have access to the printer, you can also draw margins on A4 sheet. And to know about how to draw margins, you can click the link which is available in the description and in comment section. And we hope that the participating aspirants are aware of how to upload your answers in the portal. The answer upload portal link is available in the description box and in the comment section. and this link will be disabled tomorrow evening at 6 p.m. So make sure to upload your answer before the upload portal is closed. And once the portal is closed, no answer will be accepted through email. And our regular viewers, make sure that you also upload your answers in the portal only, not in the comment section. Because the answers posted in the comment section and sent through email will not be evaluated and they will not be considered for the scholarship. And note that the reference material for yesterday's question has been given in the description section and in the comment section. And keep in mind, a new portal link will be shared for tomorrow's question. So ensure to upload the answers for today's question before 6 p.m. of tomorrow. And before uploading, note these points, that is, the file name should be renamed to your unique ID. And remember, today's portal link is different from that of yesterday's portal link. So do not upload answers for yesterday's question in today's portal link. On behalf of Shankar IAS Academy, I wish all the best to all the participating aspirants. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.